This is Theater Talk. I'm Susan Haskins. One of the casualties of the recent transit strike was our holiday critics panel. But ever celebratory, the critics have agreed to come in anyway and talk about the state of the theater now. Here to introduce them, Michael Riedel of the New York Post.
We've assembled our very own wrecking crew here tonight. Jacques Lesourd from Gannett Newspapers, Howard Kissel from the Daily News, and John Simon from BloombergNews.com.
No, forget about .com.
How do you feel, John, now that you're in the brave new world of the internet? Is it an exciting place to be?
I'm told that that magazines are dying and the web is the thing of the future. So I'm trying to be ahead of the game.
All right, gentlemen, let's have a go at some of these shows that we've got here midway through the theater season. One of them, I think you all agree, revival of Sweeney Todd is really, well, quite good. I was going to say you all agree. I know you've got something to say about that, Jacques. But Howard, you saw the original production of Sweeney Todd, the lavish Hal Prince production. This is a spared-down version. Does it work?
It didn't for me. However, I seem to be in the minority. I thought, A, unless you knew it by heart when you came in, you would be baffled. What is going on? What is all this? And I really didn't find the musical instruments more than a gimmick.
And in this case, we should say the actors.
The actors all play a musical instrument, and it is ingenious that apparently with every production they reorchestrate it for whatever instruments those actors play. But as I say, I didn't feel that it added anything dramatic. And I miss the sound of a real orchestra. I didn't think that the score had the sweep that it normally does. I thought the individual performers were fine. Patti LuPone had done that role with the Philharmonic a couple of years ago. She's, I think, even sharper now. I thought Michael Cerveris was wonderful.
As Sweeney Todd.
Yeah, but I didn't feel that the piece was as devastating as I remember it from my youth.
Now, Jacques, you had some objections against this production.
Well, I think it's a sort of a sub-reading. I mean, we've gone from, you know, Chicago, which was a very pared-down. It's the kind of show producers love because now they can do this sweeping, very expensive musical with a ladder, you know, a couple of flashlights and a kazoo, and they've got a show, you know. I mean, it's, and critics who, you know, can decry shows that are overproduced say, oh, this is so marvelous, it's minimalism. It isn't. It's a sub-reading, is my feeling. It's really not. They're good actors. There's no doubt about that. But it's not a broad, and it's not doing terribly well on Broadway because I think for Broadway people are looking for some production values.
Well, I think it's like a variation. It's like for example, when Liszt would take operatic arias and turn them into piano pieces. Why not? It's a legitimate variation on a theme. Nobody who goes to the theater doesn't know that plot. I admit that if you came from Mars, you wouldn't know what's going on.
It was 25 years ago, the original.
Sweeney Todd has been with us forever.
But
we are naive enough to assume, everybody knows Sweeney Todd.
No, not
there's
everybody.
A large world
there must be
out there.
Two people in Podunk who don't know it.
I think they're not getting tickets.
They're not getting tickets, but there are more than two people in New York. I think if we were to go right on 34th Street and ask people to describe the plot of Sweeney Todd, they'd say, what?
What?
Yeah. Well, I mean, but those people, if you get them on the Jay Leno show, they don't know who the president of this country is, which may be a good piece of criticism.
Listen, if you had a huge piece of music transcribed for one piano, would you put that pianist in the middle of the stage at the Metropolitan Opera and charge $230 a ticket, which they cost, and have everybody come in to watch a piano player and play
If it were Liszt, I would pay $230.
No, this is a question of context. Broadway is still.
This is Patti LuPone, not Liszt.
Well, yeah, but
she was wonderful. I mean, I think we're all agreed that she was wonderful.
And if it had been done in a small off-Broadway house, that would have been fine, you know, an off-Broadway production. But to have it with all the appurtenances and prices of Broadway and then give them this, I don't think it's going to...
You're making a sort of Andrew Lloyd Webber case here, Jacques, that, you know, Broadway should be spectacles, chandeliers, and helicopters, and...
Well, I'm
all that stuff that critics are supposed to hate and rail against.
No, I'm for it. It's a question of the context.
To be fair to the show, one of the things that I admired most about it was that since it was spared down, you really came away with renewed admiration for Steve Sondheim's lyrics, because it is what drives and carries the narrative and the drama of that show.
I agree. Remember, there was a production about 20 years ago, which was also pared down because they didn't have that huge hulking factory in the background, which was, that was the subtext of the original production, but it didn't matter so much. But yes, that was pared down. If this had been really dramatic, I would say, yes, I'd pay $100 for that. I didn't find it dramatic. I found it distracting. The people playing their instruments, at one point, Patty sort of does a bleat on her tuba. I thought it was funny, but I'm thinking that's Patty doing a bleat on
her
tuba.
You never forget for an instant that you're watching actors, gifted actors, doing bleeding gifted things, and you know, and this started in Liverpool, didn't it, with very minimal means. I mean, it started with, that was justified, but the idea that you can never get lost in the narrative sweep of the thing because you're aware of all this gimmickry and the actors doing
also,
this wonderful
if
stuff.
If we went out to Brooklyn or even to the Lower East Side, to some little hole in the wall and saw this, I think we would all think, wow.
Yeah, well, that is where it started in a hole in the wall.
Yeah, sure. But
so but I agree with Jacques that when you come to this neighborhood, you want not necessarily lavish the way the Brit mega musicals were, but you want a little more.
But contrast it with The Woman in White, where they have this incredibly expensive
Andrew Lloyd Webber,
set,
Jacques' favorite composer.
The most high-tech, elaborate set, and it is dead to me and meaningless. You just watch it, compare that dramatic experience.
I have to say, I found it, it's not a great musical, but I had a fun time in the theater. It was like going to a movie.
Yeah,
because, in fact,
exactly.
the projections...
That's because Howard never goes to movies. But those of us who go to movies found this, just as you say, a concert that wasn't really a concert, and a film that really wasn't the movies, although it was trying to be. But
and we should say about Woman in White, it has these, for its set, it has these video projections where you swoop around England.
It's the most elaborate video projection.
But you say it's nothing. You know, it's sort of like a Masterpiece Theater thing. It's something. It's a story. It's very gripping. It's not,
But if you read the book is a good
the
story.
Book, the book is great.
And the musical is a lousy story.
And of course, everyone has read that book except Two Boobs and Winnetka or something.
No, the trouble is that
the same people who don't know Sweeney Todd.
No, not Winnetka.
Not Winnetka. Podunk. Sorry. Yeah. I apologize to Winnetka.
Do you think Andrew Lloyd Webber's kind of run out of steam? I mean, he just celebrated the Phantom of the Opera becoming the longest running show on Broadway. The Woman in White is the new musical, not as well received as the Phantom of the Opera. I mean, has his era ended?
That's a nice question.
One should never count a writer out.
Oh, that's very sweet.
Especially
of you.
As critics.
I think
critics.
It's true. Yes, exactly. It's always...
He could always surprise us.
Exactly.
Gina Rivera, Broadway icon, legend, has her show about her life, a dancer's life, I guess it's called. Struggling at the box office, though, does it sort of... is it dismaying to you that there really isn't an audience for some of the great old Broadway stars anymore?
No, there's an audience for a Broadway star if she were in a good show, and she's we all agree she's a marvelous dancer, but she got a bum rap, or she was ill served, I think, by this show, and perhaps she doesn't have as much to say as Elaine Stritch. She's a dancer; she doesn't have all this verbalized thing to give. But it's no, we're all. I don't think it's the audience that's disappeared. The audience reads reviews and found out it wasn't worth seeing Cheetah in this really third-rate
show. What's the problem
show?
With the show?
It's not enough Cheetah in it. When it's focused on Cheetah, it's fairly good. Mm-hmm. Although it's true, she did not have the colorful life that Elaine Stritch had. No. But she's damn good, and when it's on her, it's fine. But they should have removed the rest of the show and just kept her. Just one person, one piano, center stage.
And then you would have criticized it for being spared.
I didn't criticize Elaine Stritch for that. I mean, it's true. If there's enough power there, it can work.
Mm-hmm. And you think the show doesn't serve her well?
We
should say it was written by Terrence McNally.
I know.
That's why it doesn't serve her well.
I don't know that's the problem. It doesn't come to enough of an evening. Compared to Elaine Stritch, who gives you so much. But it has to do with the fact that her life was far more interesting. Cheetah has been a trooper from the word go. I don't think she has the kind of temperament that Elaine Stritch did.
No.
She is like any good dancer. She's totally devoted to what she does.
Yeah, when she does those high kicks at age 72, that's in front of us.
But I have to take issue with you, Jacques, when you say that there's still an audience. I'm not sure there is. Who really goes to the Broadway theater? Tourists.
Well.
So Cheetah, for all of us, is a legendary figure.
They never heard
of her. For people from Podunk, even if they know the plot of Sweeney Todd, they may not know who she is.
No, but listen, a 72-year-old woman who can do the things she does, that is amazing.
Yes.
I'm willing to look at that ad infinitum.
Now, the show that everyone is going to, the big hit of the season is Jersey Boys, the Frankie Valli musical. Is this a cut above the jukebox musicals that you guys have all been trashing for the last couple of years?
I think it was. I thought it was an entertaining show. And did I grow up idolizing Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons? No.
List
and Frankie. No. But I did find their story interesting. I think it's entertainingly told. Yeah. The music has nostalgia value for me. And I had a wonderful time.
Mm-hmm. You too? Are you a Frankie Valli fan, John?
No. I didn't know Frankie Valli from Anita Hill. but it was wonderful. I expected to hate it, and I loved it. It's fun. It's well done. Those people are talented. It's well put together. It's brilliantly directed. It always gives you something to look at, maybe too much, actually. It was just totally enjoyable, and it's a mindless thing, but mindlessness is wonderful when it's well done.
And when there's a mind behind it, because there's
there's
two minds who wrote the book, and it's
yes,
intelligently
exactly.
written and fresh.
Mm-hmm. What did they do?
Let's name them. Who are the...
Marshall Brickman and Rick Ellis, yeah.
And the director was quite fabulous.
Des Magnoff,
yeah. Whose last appearance on Broadway was Dracula.
Yes, well, nobody's perfect.
He's still a good director.
And what did they do with this to sort of make it better than the typical jukebox musical? What was the...
I think it was just the quality of the writing.
Also,
we have not mentioned another jukebox musical that opened during this period, Lennon. Partly because there were so many personal agendas on the part of the creative team,
namely the widow of Lennon,
that minimized the entertainment potential of it.
We had things to learn. There were things I didn't know about Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons. They were interesting things.
No, it's true.
You weren't seeing a retread of a well-known narrative that we've all seen this. We had stuff to learn, and the way they presented it was intelligent and interesting. So,
will you be looking forward one day, John, to the minimalist version of Jersey Boys when it comes back? Where they're
well, it depends if Patty Lupone blows her horn.
That's Frankie Valli. The producer of The Color Purple has hit on this great shield against critics called Oprah Winfrey, who is turning this show into a big hit, despite what all of you have said about it, I think. Howard, you didn't care for The Color Purple, did you?
No. But you know what? Many shows have become big hits without us. I think that's just fine. Our job is not to make hits. Our job is to make judgments. I don't think that any of us were wildly enthusiastic about Wicked 2 years ago.
Oh, less than that.
Yeah, but Wicked has done extremely well even without Oprah Winfrey. Mm. Sometimes there's something about a property that sells it regardless of... I don't think it's essential that we provide quotes for things. Sometimes things do very well without us. In this case, I'm sure she has helped a lot. She's given them exposure on her show. Nobody can do that.
Mm-hmm.
But also there are people who identify with the material. I suspect none of us
do.
We identify with Oprah, of course.
Of course. Are you an Oprah fan, John?
No. And I also am disqualified from reviewing Color Purple. I'm not black. I'm not a woman. I'm not a lesbian.
No, I don't think that's fair because neither am I, and I love that.
You're not
book.
A woman.
You're not a lesbian. That's what I was thinking.
But that's a wonderful book. I didn't think that was a very good version.
Well, that's
that
right. It's exactly right. It's same as The Woman in White. A good book, bad musical. I think the novel, which I also expected not to like, but found very good indeed.
The Color Purple, which you liked the novel, yeah.
But what they did with it was junk.
Now, why? What? Where have they gone wrong in adapting the novel to the stage?
Well, first of all, they had lousy music.
Yeah,
well, secondly, they had lousy lyrics. Thirdly, it was poorly directed. Fourthly, there were no really good... All the acting was good. Nobody was bad, but there was no real stellar performance from anyone. Mm. Even though LaChance is good, but not stellar.
It really doesn't answer the question, why put this on a stage, except for the people in Podunk who will never read the novel, I suppose. But why do this on a stage?
I suspect more people in Podunk could tell you the story of the Color
That's
Purple
right.
than
That's
Sweeney
right.
Todd.
But why put it on a stage? Is there a reason for that?
I don't know.
Not really. How would sell tickets?
Now, I am an Oprah fan. I think Oprah is, and up until this James Frey thing, and I think Oprah's going to have to change her tune a little bit. She came to the defense of this book, which I don't think most of us...
It's a made-up memoir.
It's a made-up thing, and he says it's a memoir, so it doesn't have to be true. I don't think that's right. And I think Oprah will think about it a little more. But until that event, I would say, you know, if she isn't God, she's a right-hand assistant. To
well, now, Jacques, you had an interesting experience of going to the opening night of The Color
yes,
Purple.
Indeed, yeah.
You did not go to a critic's performance.
No.
And were you completely
much
dazzled
more
by...
Much more fun. I'm sorry, you guys, but it was more fun.
Were you dazzled by
dazzled.
The power of Oprah?
Yes, I was across the aisle from her, and I was dazzled. Yeah, she's a tremendous... You know, Oprah is Oprah. She's always herself. And there's no public person and then some... nasty type. Well, we've all seen that, you know, the nasty reality behind the mask. She's a real, totally, and I think she tries to be very fair with her audience.
You are Smith.
Well, I'm waiting for the stripped down Oprah when 16 people with instruments will be Oprah.
Would you pay $105 to see The Color Purple?
If I hadn't seen it, yes.
If you couldn't get in free.
Because Oprah told me to go, I'd go. Oprah told me to read the James Frey book, and I did. And
I think her credibility is on the line now. She's sending people to a not very good musical, and she's promoting a made-up memoir.
I think
this is the beginning of the end of the reign
shaking.
Of Oprah.
This is possibly rocking the Oprah
The
boat.
Empire's starting
Please,
to crumble.
Oprah, yes. She's got to save us now.
I think. All right, moving to Off-Broadway to touch on a couple of things. John, I know you're a big fan of Nilo Cruz.
Oh, yes.
He has what's his play now out there called? I can't remember.
Beauty of the Father.
Beauty of the Father, yes. Now, Nilo Cruz, Pulitzer Prize winner for the
I know, which goes to show how good a prize the Pulitzer Prize
And did that do well? I don't think so.
It didn't do particularly well, but it proved that three people adjudicating the Pulitzer Prize can be idiots.
Yes. What is your objection to Nilo Cruz?
No talent, that's
well, what. That's one for it.
No talent, and he's a polygrapher. He keeps turning out things. I've seen about five of his plays, but there must be 20 by now. All of them bad, none of them worthy of any other thing but a booby prize, maybe, of some sort. But look, I mean, he's two minorities. He is the Hispanic minority and the homosexual minority. If he were also a woman, he'd really have it made.
John Simon, you're going to get...
This is why people don't like you, John.
I'm not in the game of criticism to be liked. I'm in it to tell the truth, as I see
Howard,
it.
Howard, does something happen, though, with someone like Nilo Cruz, where they're sort of in the club because he got the Pulitzer Prize, so whether the plays are good or not, they're always going to be done by nonprofit theaters.
Chosen by boards and committees.
Absolutely, because it gives... After all, at this point, the theater is dominated by not-for-profits. It gives them a certain prestige to be doing a new play Pulitzer Prize winner Nilo Cruz. So yes, once you get in that door, you're pretty well made.
Yes, well, your foot is in the door, and your foot is in it, too.
And John is pushing against the door.
Banging that.
How about the Trip to Bountiful?
Ah.
Another off-Broadway play.
That is wonderful.
Yeah.
Absolutely wonderful.
Lois Smith.
You have to be an old woman from Texas to review it, John?
What?
You have to be an old woman from Texas to review it?
I don't know.
Which minorities does she represent?
But it's a really solid, old-fashioned play. It's a reminder that 50 years ago, you had to have an arc to a story when you put on a play. Now, you don't. You can do a little sketch. It's fine. But that's why the play is still very solid. And this production, I think, is just tremendous, especially Lois Smith.
My review came out too late, so the publicity people don't think it counts. But I said in my review that this play confers immortality on Horton Foote.
Ah.
I think it's a play that'll be with us forever. And when it's done as well as it is done here, and when it's directed as well as Harris Yulin directed it, and when it's done simply and straightforwardly, it is terrific, absolutely terrific.
We should mention our good friend
Maybe
John,
you could cut
Mr.
Out
Popularity
his
here.
Remarks about something and
pick
mention
something you could cut.
John has several doorstops of books that have just come out from Applause Books. John Simon on theater. Oh, John Simon on music. Quite a good book that has been overlooked somewhat in the reviews.
Somewhat, yes. Yes,
and,
because people don't know music.
A fine book on film. Now, Howard, you're a good friend of John's. Have you read through all of these books?
I have been reading John since I was a youth in Milwaukee. So at some point, I know I will go through these volumes and many happy memories will be restored.
But see,
I admired him from...
Now, what is it about him that makes him such a great critic?
He is a serious person. He is a person with great standards. And he's entertaining to read.
He has a sense of humor.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Did you grow up reading John Simon?
From the womb. I was going
to... And let me tell you, they love me in Podunk.
Yes,
No. Jacques first read him in translation in French.
In French,
he was delighted to see how well he writes in English.
Yes, indeed.
Is this true?
Yes.
Well, now we're running out of tape,
right,
I guess.
But let me ask you, John, what is the point, though, of, you know, for a regular reader, of going back to read reviews of old plays long since forgotten? I mean, what is the... What can one get out of reading old criticism?
Well, because the plays change, but the theater remains the same. And what is good in the theater 20 years ago in slightly different form is good today. So intelligent criticism that talks about what's good and what's bad and why it's good and why it's bad, that is always valid. Now, if it's written in an interesting way, if you have a style, if you're witty, if you're committed, if you have passion, and passion is important, then this writing is as good as any other kind of... Who is interested about the fall of a sparrow? But if a great writer writes about the fall of a sparrow, it becomes Hamlet or King Lear. Mm-hmm.
They're totally timeless. I think that's one thing about John's reviews. They could have been written 20 years ago or last week, and they're timeless and they're pure. They're a very pure study of the work that's being reviewed, and that's a nice thing, without agendas.
All right, pick up John's books. Bring a truck to the bookstore so you can get him home. Howard Kissel from the Daily News, John Simon from Bloomberg News, and Jacques Lesourd from Gannett Newspapers. Thanks for being our guest tonight on Theater Talk.
Thank you.
I want to quickly say that we are joined as an audience by members of Theater Talk's new Theater Corps, whose reviews you can read on our new Theater Corps blog at our website, theatertalk.org. We'll close now with some of their picks for highlights of the season.
Well, I would recommend In the Continuum. Yeah. I think it's a fabulous play, and I think it's a play that resonates with today. It's about HIV and AIDS in Africa and in black communities in the United States. And mm-hmm. I think it's well done, well acted, and well written.
Cool. I think people should go and just see a bloody play full of fun. So I'm recommending The Revenger's Tragedy, which has been playing at the Culture Project from Red Bull Theater. And I'm telling you, this is what plays should be. You know, I like to see no Hamlet soliloquies. I want to see somebody get their eyes gouged out.
You know, that
and
was,
I want that eye to fall
this,
across the
that
stage.
That play, the best commercial off-Broadway show still is Altar Boys. It still has a great cast. Tyler Maynard just went back into it. It's 90 packed minutes of fun and heart. The heart and soul of Altar Boys is incredible, that it's comparable to a Broadway show like the 25th annual Putnam County Spelling Bee. It has a great touring potential, and that is a show that will be with us, that we'll remember, like the Fantastics.
I'm gonna go ahead and, as a younger audience member, recommend Sweeney Todd, just because I like the paring down of, you know, an older show and looking at it from a new point of view. And I like, I think there should actually be more of that on Broadway and less of this Andrew Lloyd Webber, you know, gigantic, you know.
I would recommend The Color Purple. I think it's a show worth seeing, whether or not it's been reviewed negatively or positively. And during the show, John Simon mentioned that because he's not black, a woman, or lesbian, that he had no connection to it. And I think that was a well-spoken point, and it speaks to a lot of issues about theater, and whether or not it's universal and accepting to all people, and whether or not cultural imperialism exists in theater criticism, which is dominated by white men.
It's not playing anymore, but I think it's important to stress the Phaedra Project, which is going on at the Cherry Orchard Theater. It was a very impressive show. It was a repertoire of three different Phaedra interpretations by three different playwrights in three different times. And to get to see one director take on three plays with the same cast really gives you an idea of how many